Hello everyone, welcome to this channel. So in continuation with my previous three lectures on roof trusses, today we'll discuss a sample design problem on roof trusses. So let us get started with it. So this is the problem. So an industrial building, there's an industrial building which is having a plan area of 15 meter by 30 meter. So using the plastic analysis, we have to analyze and design the single fell portal system. Now the frame, the span of the roof truss is 15 meter and the column height is 6 meter and the rise of the principal rafter from the principal tie is 3 meter. That is, the central rise of the truss is at a height of 3 meter from the base. And these frames are spaced at 5 meter center to center. So how this 30 meter that is coming, how this is coming? Coming by multiplying 5 into 6. So you have 6 frames each having 5 meter. So the spacing from one roof truss to another roof truss is 5 meters. So between these roof truss, purlins are provided or placed at a distance of 2.7 meter center to center. So whatever the length of the rafter is coming, the purlins are placed as 2.7 meter center to center and they support asbestos cement sheets. The dead load of the roof system includes the AC sheets, the purlins and the fixtures, which comes out to be 0.4 kN per meter square. So 0.4 kN per meter square is the 0.4 kN per meter plan area of the roof, and live load is 0.52 kN per plan meter square of the roof. So this is now the problem that is described in this figure. So let us now understand here that this is the roof truss. Okay, this is your roof truss. These columns, they support the roof truss. So this is the plan area. This is the plan area on which we are doing the roof truss. So this plan consists of 15 meter, which is the width of the building, and 30 meter, which is the length of the building. So we are having, so from this figure we can conclude that we are having 6 frames, each having 15 meter span, placed at 5 meter center to center. So the plan of the building is 15 by 30 meter. So on this you are having load description is 60 kN and 300 kN is there. And theta is the angle of the pitch of the roof truss. So the data you can summarize as the building plan 15 meter by 30 meter, the width of the truss or the width of the building is 15 meter, spacing of the roof truss is 5 meter, dead load is 0.4 kN per meter square, live load is 0.52 kN per meter square, spacing of the purlin is 2.7 meter. Height is 6 meter, central rise of the truss is 3 meter, and roof cover length is. So this is the summary of the data that is given in the. So now we are doing the load calculations. So first of all, dead load that is coming on the roof is 0.4 kN per meter square, but this is the plan area. So dead load, if you want to convert this into dead load per meter run, then per meter is, we are having in one frame per meter width is 5 meter. So for per meter run, we will have dead load as 0.4 into 5, that is 2 kN per meter. Similarly, for live load, we will have 0.52 into 5, that is 2.57 or 2.6 kN per meter. So this as per, this live load is calculated as per IS 875 part 2. So as we know, this IS 875 conforms to or refers to the load calculations. IS 875 part 1 refers to live load dead load calculations. IS 875 part 2 is for live load calculations. IS 875 part 3 is for wind load calculations, and IS 875 part 4 is for seismic load calculations. So here we are concerned with only live load, dead load and wind load. So now how to calculate the wind load? Wind load is given. Before calculating the wind load, we have to find what is the design wind speed. So design wind speed is given by Vz is k1 into k2 into k3 into vv, where k1, k2, k3 are constants, where k1 is a probability factor or risk coefficient, k2 is terrain size, terrain height and structure size factor, k3 is topography factor, and vv is the basic wind speed. So basically your k1 depends on the design life of the structure. So this is a factor that is based on the design life, whether you are designing the structure for 20 years, 30 years, 50 years. So this value will come. This is a risk factor, this is probability factor. K2 and K3 are based on location, terrain, topography and geography of the place where you are constructing the structure. And VV is the basic wind speed that is flowing. So this VV will get from the wind map of India. So these values we can get directly from there. This is also given in the clause 5.3, page 8 of IS 875 part 3. So everything is, every detail is given there. So from table 1 of IS 875 part 3, K1 is taken as 1. Since risk coefficient for 50 years of design life we are taking, so K1 has to be taken as 1. So now this structure is placed in place like Chennai. So from and in a plain area, if it is a plain area or depending upon the plain area or you know, hilly area or mountainous area, depending upon the terrain. So terrain category is 4. So as per this, we are having K2 value as 0.8 and K3 is the topographic factor, is taken as 1. So every details are given in IS 875 part 3. So accordingly, we have to take the values. Now this building, as I told, is based on, is situated in Chennai. So, and the basic wind speed from the wind map of India is taken as 50 meter per second. This is from Appendix A, page 53 of IS 875 part 3. The design wind speed will be K1 into K2 into K3 into VV. So, we put all these values and get VZ as 40 meter per second. Now, design wind pressure. Design wind pressure is given by 0.6 into VZ square. So, 0.6 into 40 square is 0.696 kilonewton per meter. This is the design wind pressure. Design wind pressure that is coming on the roof truss or the walls. So wind load on individual surfaces. The wind load is calculated by this formula, CPE minus CPI, this difference into the exposure area into design wind pressure. So CPE is the external pressure coefficient, CPI is the internal pressure coefficient, A is the surface area and PD is the design wind. So internal, some information is also given about internal pressure coefficient. So the internal air pressure in a building depends on the degree of permeability of the cladding. That is the percentage of openings in the form of doors, windows in the walls, or any sort of opening that is being provided in the roof coverings. So depending on the percentage of opening, this internal pressure coefficient will vary. Because as you know, wind, any pressure will depend on the speed, on the percentage of exposed area. So if you are providing more opening, exposed area will be less. In case of buildings, like the internal air pressure may be positive or negative depending on the direction of flow of air relative to the openings. This is important. So this internal pressure coefficient is given in plus minus 6. So this will depend on the whether the wind is flowing towards the building or away from the building. So this sign has this, and this sign of the coefficients will depend on the direction of flow. So in case of buildings where claddings permit flow of air with openings not more than 5% of the wall area, and there but there are no large openings, so this is normally the case. This is normal permeability where opening is less than 5% or not more than 5%. In normal cases, this is we'll take the internal air pressure coefficients as plus minus 0.2 depending on flow direction. Two conditions shall be examined, one with internal pressure coefficient of plus 0.2 and another with internal coefficient of minus 0.2. So in this case, we are assuming that the opening is less than 5%. So very low degree of permeability, so CPI is plus minus 0.2. So for the walls, now what is the wind load that is coming on the wall? The wall, we find the height to width ratio of the building. So 6 by 15 is 0.4. So first we calculate this, and the length to width ratio, that is 30 by 15 is 2. So depending upon this height to width ratio of this building, as per appendix 12 of the external pressure coefficient CPE for roofs and rectangular clad buildings, is this appendix will have values of wind angle values and coefficient values, CPE values, central external pressure coefficient values for wind angle of theta is 0 degree and theta equals to 90 degrees. We'll have values. These values we have to interpolate from these values are given in a table in which the pitch of the roof truss, that is the angle on which the rafter is inclined, this according to this angle these values are given. So you have to interpolate values in between these angles. The first in this case this value is 0.4, so this falls in the category of h by w is less than 0.5. So this falls in the first category. So you have to see the table for the first category and then interpolate values from there. So what is the exposed area of wall frame at 5 meter center to center? This is for the wall frame, it is exposed area is 5 into 6, that is 30 meter. Wind load on the wall frame is area into design pressure. So 30 into 0.96 is 28.8 kilonewton is the wind load on the wall. So this is the wind load that is coming on the wind for wind angle 0 degree and wind angle 90 degree. Windward side and leeward side. Windward side is the side on which is facing the wind. Leeward side is the side opposite to the side that is facing the wind. So we'll have pressure, internal pressure coefficients. Both we have to take both the internal pressure coefficients, 0.2 and plus 0.2 and minus 0.2. We'll interpret these values, CPE values from the table. And then we'll find the difference, CPE minus CPI. We'll find this difference and then we'll find the what is the total wind load corresponding to these values, both on the windward side and the leeward side. Again, we'll do the same exercise for theta equals to 90 degree. For wind angle 90 degree, we'll have the same values. So thus, we'll have the total wind load that is coming for each of these values. So these values gives an idea of the what is the wind load that is coming on the walls. So for calculation of the wind load on roofs, the exposed area of each slope per frame is 5 meter length is what is the value, root over of 3 square plus 7.5. the 7.5 is half the span, so this will give the inclined value, hypotenuse of the angle, that is the purlin, length of the principal rafter. So there we are having, this is the length of the principal rafter and width is 5 meter. So what is the exposed area? 40.4. This into the design pressure will give you the total wind load that is coming on the roof truss, on the roof. Again, similarly, we can evaluate the wind load that is coming for wind angle 0 degree and wind angle 90 degree. Similar way, this CPE values that is coming in the first case, 0.328 and minus 0.328, these values have been interpolated. Since the pitch angle for the roof truss is not a multiple of 5. So the values in the table are given is multiple of 5, 5 degrees, 10 degrees, 15, 20, like that. So this value must have come out to be somewhere in the range of say 17 degree or 23 degrees. So these values are interpolated. And CPE, this is on the windward side. On the leeward side, we'll have these values. And CPI similarly plus 0.2 and minus 0.2. So then we find the difference in the other column, CPE minus CPI, and then area into the design pressure, we'll get this value. Same way, similar way, we'll find the values for the total wind load on the roof. So now dead load. So now the problem here is the dead load is given in as a distributed load of 22 kilonewton per meter. So now another point that is to be noted here is we have not decided on the number of panel points that is coming on the principal rafter. So here the purlins are placed at a spacing of 2.7 meters center to center. So the length of the principal rafter is worked out, and if we divide that length by 2.7, the number of nodal points that comes in between one principal rafter is 2. That makes there are 3 panel points on each side of principal rafter. So that makes on each side is 3, both the sides of the principal rafter will have 6 panel points. So these 6 panel points will be like acting 6 concentrated loads. This UDL will be distributed in 6 concentrated loads acting on the nodal points of the roof truss. So what is the value of this 6 concentrated load? Is given by 2 kN is the UDL for the dead load, 15 is the length, so total load will be 2 into 15 by number of panel points 6. So this will give you as 5 kN. Similarly, live load is 2.57. It was evaluated in the earlier cases, 2.57 into 15 by 6. So you have 6.4 kN. Again, you have to multiply this load by suitable partial safety factors. For dead load, gamma F is 0.5. For live load, it is 1.5. For dead load, is it 1.5. For accompanying live load, it is 1.05. Material safety factor, gamma is 1.1. So multiplying these values with suitable factors will have these values. So from the same table, we'll find the values of the load combination. So first load combination is 1.5 times dead load plus live load. This is limit state values because it is multiplied with 1.5. Now second combination is dead load plus live load and wind load multiplied by 1.2. Third combination is 1.5 times dead load plus live load. So for these three values, we'll find what are the values that is coming. Well, then we'll find what is the maximum positive value and the minimum positive values. Once we arrive at this, then we'll take the maximum positive value will be the compression member, minimum negative value will be the tension members. And then taking those values, we'll design the compression members and the tension members for each of the member of the roof truss. So this is how the design procedure is completed. So design loads include the dead load, live load, snow loads and wind loads. Another important load is snow load. If the pitch of the slope is more than 50 degrees, then snow load is neglected since the snow will get drained off. So in such cases, you do not need snow load. Snow load is only for places where snowfall occurs. The member size, strength, characteristics are also worked out. Maximum design deflection for each of the members of the roof truss and shop drawings. So this entire thing will complete the design of roof truss. Thank you.